Good evening and welcome to the Pasadena Public Library's 15th annual One City, One Story celebration. I'm Tim McDonald. I'm the interim deputy director of libraries here in the city of Pasadena. One City, One Story is a proud tradition that invites members of the community to engage with one another as we read one thought-provoking book together. To my left, you'll see some colorful posters of past titles that we've read together. This year, we celebrate The Sympathizer by Pulitzer Prize-winning author Viet Thanh Nguyen. It's my honor to start off the evening by thanking the many people that support this event. First and foremost, I'd like to thank the All Saints Church for giving us a spectacular venue for tonight's program. I'd especially like to thank Administrative Assistant Debbie Daniels for her help coordinating tonight's program. Many important people in the audience that have supported the Pasadena Public Library and this event over a long period of time. I'd like to thank some of those important people that are in the audience tonight. The Director of Public Health for the City of Pasadena, Mike Johnson, is in the audience tonight. Thank you very much for being here and for your support of the Public Library. The Library Commissioners, who are constant positive advocates for the library, are here supporting tonight's event. The Chair of the Library Commission, Victor Gonzalez, thank you very much for your support. Also, Commissioner Carla Bluestone, thank you very much. Yeah. Commissioner Traude Gomez-Ryan, thank you. And also, Commissioner Sharon Calkin is here tonight. Thank you. And Sharon has a special distinction of, as well as being a commissioner, was on the panel that helped select this year's title, which I'll talk about later, too. The One City, One Story Commission committee has an enormous task of reviewing some outstanding nominees before selecting the annual title that we're celebrating tonight. And in attendance tonight, Sharon, as I mentioned, also Rosemary Choate is here, thank you. Sally Kauser, Maggie Reyes-Rothner, and a VIP on the team, our former library director, Jan Sanders, was also on that committee. Thank you. And most importantly of all, the sponsors of tonight's program, the Friends of the Pasadena Public Library, and their president, Mary Downey, who is selling books right over there. Thank you, Mary. Thank you, Mary. Okay. And finally, I've got some bad news and I've got some good news. The bad news is our wonderful new library director, Michelle Pereira, has come down with a terrible case of laryngitis. So, although she's here in the audience tonight, she's not going to be able to lead the conversation with the author as I know she had hoped to. But Michelle, could I ask you to stand so the audience can see if Michelle's here? Thanks. And I know Michelle looks forward to meeting all of you and hosting future events. We're happy to have her here in Pasadena. So, the good news is we have someone with a little bit of experience running this program back to step in and help us out, and that's our much beloved and recently retired library director, Jan Sanders. Thank you very much, Jan. And with that said, to formally welcome you to tonight's event, could you please join me in a round of applause for our mayor, Terry Tornick. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you.
Well, good evening. It's really a privilege to be here tonight. As was noted, this is the 15th anniversary of our community reading program, One City, One Story. The program was created in 2002 to promote the value of reading by recommending a compelling book that links the community in a compelling common conversation. It's the kind of community-based activity that really makes Pasadena a terrific place to live. This popular program has grown dramatically over the 15 years, with book discussions and events offered at all 10 library sites, and please note that Pasadena has 10 libraries. And throughout Pasadena, in partnership with local community organizations, thousands of Pasadenans have participated in One City, One Story events and activities over the years. This year's book, The Sympathizer, is being celebrated with an array of programming planned during the month of March, built around the theme of the book. Tonight's conversation with the author, Viet Thanh Nguyen, is truly a highlight, one of which the community looks forward to attending, as is evidenced by all of your presence here tonight. We're glad that you're here to enjoy the discussion and learn more about what inspired this novel and what the author's experiences were writing The Sympathizer. I know it was a challenging read for me because of the subject matter and the period it covers, both in our country's history and my personal history. And now, without further ado, I'd like to introduce a person who really needs no introduction for most of you, our retired but irrepressible library director, Jan Sanders, who will introduce the 2017 One City, One Story author. Jan.
Let the games begin.
All right, I'm ready.
This is fun. We've had this event in this location a few times, but I don't recall that we ever filled it quite so full. So that's a testament to, if you'll pardon the pun, here in the sanctuary, that's a testament to your pull and the excitement that people feel in having you come to speak to us. Well,
it's a thrill to be here. And
kudos to you.
Yeah, I think it's the first time I've been in church in a few years, actually. it's a good occasion to be back.
Well, we'll try to make it as painless as we can.
That's a new experience.
So this was for the selection committee, one of the simplest choices we made. You can see the array of titles behind me of all of the books that, or many of the books that we've handled. And we start out with about 50 titles. And argue and coax and cajole and argue and coax and cajole until we get down to a final few. But this year, everybody was pretty much on board with asking you as our first choice right off the bat.
That's so unlike my experience in grade school.
Like, you know, when you're trying to pick the dodgeball,
yeah, it's always the last one chosen.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
So I have my revenge. Yeah.
Well.
The nerd wins.
Maybe you found your game.
Yeah, exactly.
Maybe
that's
you
what
found
I'm saying.
Your game. Yeah.
Nerds
yeah.
are good at books.
It's all good. So we were very excited that you were available to us. And I have to say that Viet has made himself so accessible to us through this entire process by answering emails and answering phone calls and all of that kind of thing. You know, sometimes we go through an agent and it gets a little cumbersome, shall I say. But this whole experience has been very smooth and very easy, and thank you for your accessibility to us. We appreciate that.
Thank you. My parents
raised me that way. We feel like you're one of our hometown heroes anyway. So even though you're Silver Lake, close enough.
Yeah.
Close enough. We're going to take it. So the good mayor indicated that this was a tough read, and that actually is the comment I've heard the most as I talk to people about your book, because it is many, many layers of meaning. The prose is beautiful, and there's a lot of it.
Right.
And there's a lot going on, and the characters are multidimensional. But I think the thing that sort of holds the whole thing together, at least for me, was this whole concept of duality. And you bring that up right in the very first sentence. So talk to us a little bit about what that meant to you, what you're trying to get across with that, how you were able to sustain that and bring in all kinds of pros and cons and yings and yangs and salt and pepper all the way through the whole book.
Yeah. Well, first of all, you know, I'm sorry that it's a tough read. I like easy reads,
well,
but I like tough reads as well. But you know, the thing is, when I was writing the novel, I didn't feel that it was a tough read. I was like writing it in chortling, you know, having a good old time. And I thought, well, it must be a unique experience for me in that case to think it was an easy one.
I think they meant tough in the sense of not light beach reading.
Right, right, right.
Which it definitely is not.
I would not argue
light
about
beach
that.
Reading. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So anyway, but the duality issue. Well, you know, that is the autobiographical element in the novel. Now, the fact that the narrator, the protagonist, is a liar, a traitor, a spy, an alcoholic, a womanizer, a murderer, that's not autobiographical, you know, as you'll be relieved to know. But yeah, but the experience of duality was something that I grew up with as someone who came as a refugee to the United States when I was 4 years old. And you know, I grew up as an American boy, but that meant that when I was in my parents' Vietnamese house, I felt like a spy from the outside observing their strange Vietnamese customs. And then when I stepped out into the larger American world, I felt like I was a Vietnamese person spying on strange American customs. So there was always that sense of never quite belonging wherever I happened to be, and always that sense of being a person with dual identities, dual heritages. And that whole line from W.E.B. Du Bois when he speaks about African Americans and says that the experience of African Americans is always one of two-ness. Seeing the world through your own eyes and seeing yourself through the eyes of others was true for me too. And at the same time, I didn't want to write about myself because I've had a very boring life. So you definitely don't want to read about my autobiography. But I thought I can take that sense of duality, which I think is actually very universal for many of us, especially those of us who are minorities, however you choose to define minority. That sense of two-ness is really prevalent. So I thought I'm going to take that sense of two-ness and graft it onto a spy novel. Because spies do deal with exactly that same sense of duality, and then I'm going to exaggerate that emotional sense of never belonging anywhere and merge it with this figure of the notorious spy.
Well, I think it's interesting that you know so much of his experience is about spying, and that brings such a different feel to the novel. And yet there's some really funny parts. There's some really funny parts in this book. I'm always intrigued with how people are able to write comedy. Did you crack yourself up as you were writing?
You know what? I mean, I didn't know I had a sense of humor before I wrote this novel. I didn't set out to write. Yeah, I did not set out to write a black comedy. But you know what happened was I created this character, and then I created his voice. And lo and behold, once he started commenting on the things that he saw, it turned out to be kind of funny. But because if you have a jaded and cynical consciousness and you look out at this world, you have to laugh. If you're not laughing, you're not seeing the absurdities and the hypocrisies, and he sees those absurdities and hypocrisies. Now, that doesn't explain the episode with the squid. There's nothing, you know, that's not a commonplace type of incident, you know. But
I don't know that I'd ever read anything quite like that in another book. It's interesting.
Right, and I did not plan that happening. So there was something about coming up with this character that allowed me to tap into parts of myself that I didn't really know existed, and that was actually a lot of fun. And I think it was actually really necessary for the novel, because the novel is dealing with some really terrible stuff.
It is.
Right? And of course, you could write a novel that's completely serious about terrible stuff, but it helps if you can throw a joke in every now and again at the same time.
Well, there's some wonderful overstatement. There's a line in there about the guy is saying, thank goodness we were on a truce at this particular time and only 150,000 people were killed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, isn't that good news? So there are those wonderful cryptic pieces that really kind of jar you back into reality. I know I've talked to a lot of people about the book, and many people in my age group were really taken with the validity and the accuracy of those opening pages talking about the fall of Saigon. Because many of us who watched that on American television in very formative times of our lives, I was a college student, many of the people in this room, how many of you remember the fall of Saigon? You were in your young adulthood, right? So talk to us a little bit about how you recaptured that, because you obviously weren't there at that particular time, or at least in the sense that you could remember it all that heavily.
Right. No, I was there. But you know, yes, I did not remember, thankfully. Yeah. I'm sure it was a very unpleasant experience for my parents at that moment in Saigon. But you know, there's an advantage and a disadvantage to writing about something like that, because everybody here has seen these images from the fall of Saigon and remembers it, or even if they didn't live through it, think that they remember it from seeing these iconic types of images with the helicopter on the roof and so on. So on the one hand, that gives me an advantage because everyone here, most of the people here have a base, have some kind of ability to identify with what's happening, but then it's a real challenge because all of you will think, well, as Michael Hurst said in Dispatches, Vietnam, we've all been there. So that poses a real, you know, challenge for me in terms of trying to write a scene that would be convincing. So what I did was I read every book available and every article available about the fall of Saigon to capture all the various kinds of details that people saw from different parts of the city and from different perspectives. And that allowed me to pick the right kinds of incidents and to plot the timeline so that I knew exactly what was happening week by week, day by day, hour by hour, and then literally minute by minute in the last few pages of that opening section. And hopefully that hopefully by drawing on all those real details to create this illusion of reality that pulls the reader in.
You obviously did a lot of research to make this book come alive for the rest of us, but did you find in your research, did you find an affirmation of your family's story as you had heard it through your interactions with your your kin, or did you find yourself looking at things differently based on the research?
Well, you know, when I was growing up, my parents would tell me stories, some of the stories about what had happened to them and what life was like in South Vietnam, but they would only tell me what they wanted me to know, and they wouldn't necessarily.
That's the privilege of a relative, right?
That's the privilege of your parents, yeah. But they wouldn't necessarily answer my questions. And so I knew that I was getting a very small sliver of what it is that had actually happened to them. And one of the things in doing the research for the novel, and just talking about this particular moment of the fall of South Vietnam, was to read about historical incidents that my family were involved in. So my family lived in this small town of Ban My Thuot in central Vietnam, which had the distinction of being the first town overrun in the final invasion. And my dad was in Saigon on business. My mom was at home with my 10-year-old brother and 4-year-old me, and with the lines of communication cut off, she had to make a life and death decision about what to do, not knowing what my father would do. So she decided to take my brother and me and walk 184 kilometers to the nearest port town. Fortunately, it was all downhill. And from there, try to catch a boat to get to Saigon. Now that all sounds like a very, that already sounds bad, right? But then doing the research for this and reading about what life was like during these final weeks of South Vietnam, it was horrible. You know, there were tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people fleeing from these cities and towns, trying to make it to ports, trying to get on a boat to get out of the war zone. South Vietnamese soldiers were doing the same thing. It was total chaos, and people were being killed left and right. And that was what was happening around my family, and I have no memory of that. So it gives me a greater sense of my own history, but also a greater sense of what it is, what kind of a decision my mother had to make, and what it is that she had to endure. Because again, I don't remember any of it, and I'm thankful for not being able to remember what my brother remembered at 10 years old. He wrote a story about it. He remembered dead paratroopers hanging from the trees. I'm thankful not to know these things, except now with the distance of research. But it gives me such great appreciation for what it is that the people of my parents' generation went through, what they must have suffered, what they must have felt.
Yeah.
And gives me great empathy for the fact that so many of them were not able to leave the past behind them, given what it is that they had witnessed.
Well, I mean, you can only imagine how ingrained that becomes. You know, I think it would be a horrible thing. Your mother must be an incredibly brave woman.
She is.
Resourceful and smart.
You know, my parents
Let's give mom some credit.
No. I'm giving mom credit. Giving mom credit.
Absolutely.
My mom saved my life at that point, and she saved my life again later when I was 16. I have a new book out called The Refugees, sales pitch, and there's only one autobiographical story I've ever written. It's called War Years and Refugees. It's based on the refugee shopkeeper lives that my parents led in San Jose in the 1980s, and talks about real things that happened to our family, including how a man came knocking on our door in San Jose one day in the mid-80s, and when we opened the door, put a gun in our faces. It was a home invasion. And my mother saved our lives again, because when the man said, get on your knees, my dad got on his knees, I got on my knees, and my mom decided to run right past him out the door and into the street. And that's what saved our lives. So she's a very brave, resourceful, and remarkable woman.
Is she the pattern for any of the women in your store?
If you know anything about...
Bits of her, maybe? Pieces of her?
Not in the Sympathizer. I mean, many of the characters in the Sympathizer are based on real-life personages. So if you know anything about Vietnamese history, you'll recognize some of these inspirations. But not my mother explicitly. But, you know, I think the idea of Vietnamese women enduring a lot. If you know anything about Vietnamese men, you know Vietnamese women endure a lot, okay? In addition to just suffering through this period of history and being refugees and all of that. And I think that spirit of being able to fight back, being able to survive, infuses many of the characters in the book, especially the mother of the Sympathizer in the novel.
Yes, because hers was not an easy path either. It was interesting to me that you chose to make the narrator of dual personalities in so many ways, not least of which is his identity as a bastard. You know, that he has the Vietnamese mother and the Catholic priest as the father. So you can just see the dichotomy of his life. Every topic that you come up with, every personality trait that you come up with him is a...
Right. Well, I wanted the novel to be many things. So it's definitely a political novel, spy novel, historical novel, but it's also a novel that's a commentary on the East-West divide. You know, that whole idea from Kipling that East is East and West is West and never the twain shall meet. But it would be really boring if it was a novel in which Viet, the professor, stepped in and started to give these lectures about the differences between East and West. So instead, I wanted to create a character who embodied these kinds of differences and who could logically talk about them because they infused his life. And I also wanted to create a character who wasn't 100% Vietnamese. I grew up, my father would always say to me, "We are 100% Vietnamese," which makes me think maybe he protested too much. But anyway, but if you know anything about Vietnamese people, you know that we're also just as racist as every other population on Earth. And people who were Eurasian or Amerasian, and there were many of them in Vietnam because of French colonization and the American presence, were treated really badly by Vietnamese people. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to incorporate that experience. And I didn't want to have a Vietnamese narrator in this novel because I'd just written The Refugees, and it's all about Vietnamese people. And you know, the danger about writing about your own people is that you might give in to the temptation of idealizing them. Especially if you think your people have been treated badly for one reason or another, and you think, well, I'm going to write stories about them to humanize them, which is what I did in the Refugees.
Right.
There's a real human tendency to forget how your own people, after having been victimized by other people, like the French, turn around and victimize others. Uh-huh. And I wanted to draw attention to that by making my character a mixed race person.
It's interesting that one of the things he is most proud of, or seems to be proud of, is this idea that he has come to Occidental College or some other unnamed Southern California establishment and learn English with no accent. Mm-hmm. You know, he brings that up again and again and again. Mm-hmm. Does that make him feel more of an American? Was that part of plot development with that? Yeah.
You know, I mean, I grew up in the United States in the 70s and 80s, and then, and even today, from what I've been hearing, you know, the perception of Asian immigrants and Asian Americans in this country historically has been that we don't belong here. We're not really Americans, we're foreigners, we don't speak good English, and all of that. And so that definitely was in my mind in creating this character, that his capacity to be a spy depends on his ability to convince Americans that he's just like them. Mm-hmm. And Americans, you know, will believe that if you can speak perfect English. But you could have lived here for 50 years, and if you have an accent, Americans will believe you're not like them. You know, and as a writer, I also knew that was important as well, because I knew that I would have to prove that I was an American writer. And the equivalent of doing that, in terms of writing, was the equivalent of not speaking with an accent would be to write beautiful English. And that's one of the reasons why the novel is difficult at mm-hmm. the level of prose, because I wanted to demonstrate that I could write just as well as anybody else. So there's an anxiety there, I think, in the novel in terms of trying to prove that mastery of English.
Yeah, I think you nailed it. I think you got that. You got that. Mm. Mm. I haven't had this experience because I haven't listened to the audio book of this title. Have any in the audience done it as an audio book? A few of you had. Have you listened to it?
I've listened to half of it. And it's narrated by an actor named Francois Chow, who's a really good actor, and he happens to be Vietnamese, I discovered, except that he was born in Cambodia, and then he left at a young age. And so his French is perfect, and his Vietnamese is not so good. And mine is the reverse. He has a deep, gravelly voice. It's a really wonderful narration. I only listened to half of it because by that point, I was sick of hearing my own novel. But it's a really good version.
Okay. Well, it's just interesting. It seems like that would bring a different layer again to the experience. You mm-hmm. know, hearing it said like that. It's interesting because we, as you know, the saying is those who win the war get to write the history. And in your book, one of the ways that the history is captured is, of course, through the films. Through the movies, what propelled you to put what was essentially, I'm assuming, Apocalypse Now, in the middle of this novel?
Yeah, obviously.
I just thought that was a really cool plot twist.
Right. Well, if you read the acknowledgments, you know, you read that, uh-huh. that it is clearly Apocalypse Now because uh-huh. I cite basically every book written about Apocalypse Now and Francis Ford Coppola I read for this novel, and you know the reason why I did that was because I grew up as an American boy in the 70s and 80s, and I was watching American movies. And I was also really interested in war. You know, I just liked machine guns and tanks and all that kind of stuff. So I was watching all these American war movies, and it was great. I really enjoyed them. You know, I enjoyed watching the John Wayne movies and identifying with John Wayne as he fought the Japanese and so on. And then, at about 10 or 11 years old, I came across this movie called Apocalypse Now. And this was after I'd watched Star Wars for a dozen times on the VHS, right? And then, okay, now I'll watch Apocalypse Now. And I put it in, and was identifying with the American soldiers up until the point they killed Vietnamese people. And I thought, where am I supposed to be in this movie?
Exactly.
Am I the American or am I the Vietnamese? Am I the killer or am I the killed? And I think when we identify only with the person who's doing the shooting and the killing, it's not a problem for us. That's why we watch movies like American Sniper and make it into a big hit. But if you are on both sides of the gun, then you experience that moment of split identity and split self. And I really did feel that I was split in two as I was watching that movie. And it was actually a very traumatic experience for me, and it marked me for a very, very long time. And it was one of the moments that turned me, or made me want to become a writer eventually, because I realized that I would have to say something about this. I would have to not allow Americans to get away with this, because Americans did get away with this. When I was writing my nonfiction book, Nothing Ever Dies. And I told people that I was writing about the Vietnam War. One of the most common responses was, have you seen Apocalypse Now? All over the world, including from Vietnamese people. Hmm. So the power, not just of Apocalypse Now, but all that it symbolizes in terms of America's cinema industrial complex, its ability to project its soft power all over the world and to tell its story, meant that I was up against a lot. I was up against literally thousands of books and hundreds of movies of the American version of the Vietnam War. And so with my one book, my one shot, as Lin-Manuel Miranda says, I gotta take it. And I have to get my revenge against Hollywood with this long episode in the novel about Apocalypse Now.
But the narrator was so disappointed because he was not in the credits.
Right.
He was very disappointed that he got left out of the credits.
Right, well, because that's reality. You know, it would be a complete fantasy if he went in and either was able to sabotage the film or became the movie star.
Oh yeah.
You know, but the reality of history, unfortunately, the reality of history is that many people end up disappeared into oblivion, either literally in the course of a war, never to be remembered, or in the course of the making of this movie, consigned to the credits where the Vietnamese extras appear as VC rapist number one, mm-hmm. crazy guy in whorehouse, but never with a name. Right. But at least they even have the epithet. Our narrator has been so erased from the making of this movie that he doesn't even appear in the credits at all. He's rendered nameless, and he realizes that this is a tremendous act of violence. To be killed is an act of violence, right? But to be erased from history, to be nameless, mm-hmm. is an act of violence, symbolic violence, that we do all the time. And that's what Hollywood does. You know, it takes other people's stories and appropriates them for America. You know, so the story could be set in India, it could be set in Vietnam, it could be set in Korea, but it's all about Americans. And the people in those countries are rendered nameless. And that is a tremendous act of erasure that I wanted to fight against.
That's a frightening thought. Talk to us a little bit about the title.
The Sympathizer.
The Sympathizer.
Yeah. Well, it's a better title than The Empathizer, which might have been a more accurate
title. But nobody
knows
what that means. So,
yeah, right, exactly. Nobody knows what that
people,
means.
People
yeah.
misuse that word, so right. Sympathizer is probably a better choice.
Well, you know, I mean, it's a title that has multiple meanings, obviously. So, and there are many words in the book that have multiple meanings. And of course, he is a sympathizer in the sense of being someone who is a communist spy. But he's a sympathizer in the sense that his one talent, as he tells us from the opening paragraph, is to see any issue from both sides and to identify with anybody's perspective. And that is what makes him a great spy, but it's also his tragic flaw. And it's what's going to undo him in the end. Because in order to be a successful revolutionary, you have to stop being sympathetic. Your ability to sympathize with the poor and the oppressed people of the world is what makes you into a revolutionary. But in order to be successful in completing a revolution, you have to turn that sympathy off in order to eradicate your enemies. And it's between these polar opposites that he finds himself caught by the end of the novel. And of course, he stands in as a figure for the writer. You know, he writes his confession, but a writer has to be a sympathizer too. A good writer has to be a sympathizer. A good writer has to be able to empathize with people who are completely different from her or from him. And be able to empathize oftentimes with people who are either on a completely opposite, from a completely opposite cultural perspective, or who might even be an enemy, or who is doing terrible things. That's our job as writers, is to spy on other people.
So are you going to join the CIA? No. Okay, probably not. I think there's a wonder to me in the story about the capacity to see things sort of from both sides, and at times, you know, we're looking through the eyes of the North Vietnamese and then the South, you know, and we have all of these things playing against each other, and the idea that you can take your reader into a different context and a different reaction to some of those things, I thought was just pretty incredible. Yeah.
That's what we're supposed to do, you know, and I mean, for example...
Well, that's what good books do. It's not what all books do.
But that's what we're supposed to do, right? And, you know, as a writer, if you only write about the people that you know or the things that you know, you might be able to produce one good book. But after that, it gets increasingly difficult to constantly talk about the same things over and over again. So the challenge for a writer is to try to imagine people who are really, really different from themselves. So even though this book is about the Vietnam War and about a lot of Vietnamese people, and even though I'm Vietnamese, I don't know most of these people, right? And I had to try to imagine what it was like to be a general, or what it was like to be a lounge singer, or what it's like to be a communist. Mm-hmm. And that requires trying to put myself into the position of other people. And it's a habit of mind, I think. I mean, it's something that I do in the privacy of my own room while I'm writing, but as a writer, writers are always trying to keep that sensibility alive. You know, that's why when I meet people, I like to ask them questions to hear what they have to say, because people usually like answering questions about themselves. They like to talk about themselves. Yeah, but most people aren't curious about other people, and you have to be curious about other people in order to be a writer.
We have a few questions here, and I'll state a few of those for you, if you'd be willing to take some questions from the audience. And if you think of a question as we are talking, or as you're reflecting on your own experience with the book, feel free to jot that down. Are forms still available? Everybody who knows anything has left, so... We're going to assume that forms are still available, so if you'd like to write a question, feel free to do that, and you can wave it in the air, and the inimitable Catherine Haney over here will collect your questions from you. So, a couple of questions about process. I thought this was interesting. First of all, everybody wants to know what you're working on next. What's the next story? But before we get to that, I want you to tell us a little bit about the experience of getting the Pulitzer Prize.
Well,
I mean, because I'm envisioning this, you know, whole red carpet kind of thing, and they call you, and someone comes to your door with roses, like when you win the Publisher's Clearinghouse or something.
Yeah.
Right?
It would have been awesome if that was the way it was, you know. But, you know, what happened was that I was on book tour in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and it was in the afternoon, and I was doing emails, as I usually do on book tour, and all of a sudden, Facebook and Twitter start to make all this noise. And I look at the message, and I'm like, are you kidding me? Is this what happened? So first thing I got to do is I got to call my wife and tell her, I think I won the Pulitzer. Second thing I did was I called my publicist and said, did I really win the Pulitzer? And they went on the Pulitzer website and said, yes, you did. And that's how I heard about it. No phone call, no letter, nothing like that.
That's kind of disappointing, isn't it? This is a big deal.
It has its own kind of drama, yeah.
Yeah, well.
But then we had a very nice dinner later.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I guess that makes up for some of it then. And someone has a question about the cover. Uh-huh. I'm assuming the cover to the paperback. Well, it's the same cover, hardback too, I think. And the question is, her comment is, book covers, this person's comment, book covers say a lot about the book and its contents. How long and how many covers did you work on? Well, I'm guessing probably you didn't actually draw this cover.
No.
Okay.
No, but so my publisher asked me for my input on various kinds of ideas for what the cover would look like, gave them a bunch of ideas, and then also asked me, what don't you want on the cover? I said, I don't want red and gold on the cover.
Nice to know you have a lot of pull.
Right, exactly. Yeah. It's grown on me though since it's been out there.
Well, it does make a nice splash among other books, which I suppose is what your marketing people were going for.
Right. So the reason why they don't pay any attention to authors is that the marketing people are much smarter than authors when it comes to selling the books.
Well, that's a whole different conversation, I guess. So what is next? What are you writing on next?
The sequel to The Sympathizer. So if you make it to the end of The Sympathizer, I'm not going to give anything away. He lives at the end of The Sympathizer. And the sequel to The Sympathizer is called The Committed. And it takes up his adventures exactly where we leave him off at the end of The Sympathizer. And he's on his way to Paris of the 1980s.
Wow. So is this going to be like a trilogy or...
Talk to me after I finish the sequel,
okay.
And then we'll see.
We'll see.
You know, I wanted to send him to Paris because I wanted him to deal with the other side of his heritage, his French priest father, and to deal with French colonialism, but it's also going to be a thriller. It's still going to be a thriller. So The Sympathizer is about the Vietnam War and spying and everything, and The Committed, set in Paris of the 1980s, is about the drug trade. Because the French financed their colonial empire through drugs. Right? Did you know this? That the cultivation and selling of opium in Indochina was really crucial to the financial operations of French colonialism, and the French, you know, that and that this was part of the origins of the heroin trade in Southeast Asia that would eventually filter its way into the United States.
Interesting. So, what about movies? Are you talking to anybody about? Movie?
It's
Southern California.
Southern California, of course. Yes, I mean that's all that people care about in Southern California. You know, I heard another author say, "Yeah, no one really cares about your novel unless they turn it into a movie." He's speaking about his friends, and it's pretty much true. Everybody wants to know: is it going to be turned into a movie? I'd rather have it be turned into a television series, and the reason why is because when I was writing the novel in 2011 to 2013. I hadn't watched TV for literally a decade. And I had finally 2 years off to write this novel and had all this free time in the evenings. So what I did was I watched a lot of TV. So I watched all the TV shows that people have been talking about for the previous decade, The Sopranos, Mad Men, The Wire, The Shield. And the dramatic structure of those shows and the fact that they were mostly all about anti-heroes,
right,
men doing bad things and us loving them as spectators, really helped to influence the book. And so that's why the novel, it's, I think it's 26 chapters in the novel, all the chapters are of the same length. Because that just, you know, I thought of them as episodes, and it just made, it was literally 20 pages, I'm done. And it just made, you know, plotting the novel that much easier when I didn't have to worry about the length of the chapters. So anyway, we're in this long set of protracted negotiations with the various kinds of producers and actors and directors. We'll see if anything ever happens.
Well, interesting. Someone wants to know what inspired you to create the character of the narrator, and why is he nameless throughout? Okay.
Well, what inspired me to create this character was that I wanted to have someone who could reasonably say all the things that I always wanted to say. And again, you know, you don't want to read a novel in order to hear the author dropping lectures into the book. So I had to create a fictional setting and a fictional character who really could be really critical of American culture and Vietnamese culture, who really was a Marxist, who could engage in a Marxist critique of the United States, and who was really intelligent enough to be our political commentator as well. Because I wanted the novel to be not just an entertainment, and I didn't want the novel to do what American contemporary fiction typically does, which is to show and not tell. That's the mantra that's dominant in the literary scene. I wanted a novel that showed, that both showed things and told things. The novel that could have some didactic elements as well, because I wanted the novel to be a political novel. And in the United States, for the most part, we don't read political novels and we don't like political fiction. We don't think that it can work. And I wanted to show that it could work. Mm-hmm. And so I had to make a very conscious set of, you know, aesthetic decisions about who this character was and how I would tell this story in order to make the political critique possible. And that's why the novel is written as a confession from one Vietnamese person to another Vietnamese person. Because what this does is that it sets up the novel so that anybody who's not Vietnamese is listening in, right, on this conversation.
Right.
And I think for the most part, in contemporary American fiction, this is not the usual position that American readers find themselves in. They, for example, when it comes to minority fiction in this country, American readers expect books to talk to them, to explain history, sociology, the minority culture in question, mm-hmm, to the dominant reader. And this is a position that I absolutely refused to take on because it deforms literature. If you think about it, Jonathan Franzen doesn't have to explain a damn thing to you, okay? He can say sandwich and you know what a sandwich is. If I were to say pho, I would have to say, comma, a delicious beef noodle soup, right? And automatically, by putting myself in the position of being a translator, I've weakened myself as a writer, because majority writers don't have to do that. So my ambition in writing the novel was to write the novel as if I were a part of the majority, so I wouldn't have to translate anything. And because the novel is set up to, from one Vietnamese person speaking to another Vietnamese person, this is where the political critique happens. Because instead of translating Vietnamese culture to American audiences, the novel translates American culture to Vietnamese audiences. And that's where I could reverse, I could, you know, turn the tables on American audiences, and I could illuminate American culture from the inside and the outside.
Yeah, I think that was one of the really interesting aspects of the novel, because looking at ourselves as Americans through a completely different lens, mm-hmm, you know, through that whole, I am not American, so here's what I think, and I think the candor of the Vietnamese people talking to each other was really pretty amazing too, because you took that was a very, I would think that was rather a freeing thing to have those kinds of conversations.
Right. I wanted the novel to be very honest. I wanted the novel to say things that typically aren't said. I think that, again, I don't think it's a burden placed upon minority writers, but this fear of speaking the complete truth, because the complete truth might offend people, is something that minority writers struggle with. But I think all of us struggle with that. You know, we're always repressing ourselves and censoring ourselves out of fear of offending people. And I wanted to write a novel that offended everybody, because that's the only way to get at the truth. If you only offend a select portion of the audience, then people will obviously think that you're being prejudicial, right? But if you offend everybody, then hopefully you're engaging in equal opportunity criticism.
I know there are some people in the audience who haven't completed the novel, but what kind of comments have you had from your readers about that startling, rather shattering ending?
Well, I mean, it depends. I think that it's an unsettling ending for a lot of people. It was an unsettling ending for me because I didn't know that was where the novel would end up. But about two-thirds of the way through the novel, well, first of all, in writing the novel, I knew that the narrator was speaking to someone, but I didn't know who. Two-thirds of the way through the novel, I realized it was a confession in a re-education camp. And then I realized exactly how it must end, with torture and interrogation. Uh-huh. And it was a difficult ending to write, and it was a difficult ending to write partially because I had to imagine what it was like to undergo these experiences, but partially also as a writer, it's difficult to write about these things. You know, it's difficult to write about it and try to make it entertaining at the same time, but I appreciated the challenge. So in terms of audience responses, I think some people think this is too much, and some people think this is just right. And that's the right kind of response, I think, because having an ending that unsettles the writer and unsettles the reader can be really powerful. And
absolutely.
You know, you might have to stop and think about this for a while before you decide whether this is the right ending for you.
Well, it's like much of other kinds of art. You want to leave us asking more,
right.
Wanting more,
yeah.
Getting more,
right.
More information. There are so many questions here that we're not going to get to, and I'm very sorry about that. But I'm told that we've hit our time limit, which is really too bad. But I do want to thank our author for being here. And Viet has very graciously agreed to sign. I assume this is the signing table over here. So if you have a book, if you have not bought a book, are they still available or not?
Thank you very much, everyone, for your participation tonight. Books sales will be here on the south. Book signings will start over here on the north side, yes. And Jan, we'd like to make a special thank you to you for stepping in at the last minute too to run the show. Thank you.
Thank you. That's so kind. That's so kind.
And thank you
all
for
coming. Come back next year. Yeah. In the meantime, visit your Pasadena Public Library. Yeah. Good night.